Yeah, asking to Alessandro Giacchetto for the ninth version of this GR seminar.
So my goal and today's talk is the continuation of the last talk about topological recursion and intersection theory. So just to recap a bit. So with this talk, what we did was to first talk about topological classes. And in particular, we saw example psi, kappa, and lambda classes. And then we went to some models of the modular space of curves. There are the concentric models. And then just quickly get back on it. So in both of these cases, the situation was something like this. So we have a fiber bundle where the fibers were something like this. So I will. These are in these two models the moduli space is the combinatorial or hyperbolic moduli space. And in both of them we have a symplectic form, which is the Concevich or the Van-Richardson form. So these are the fibers, and then we have again, this whole space. And the base the space is in both cases R plus 2EM. So, as I said, these are models of the moduli space of curves in the sense that these guys here are holomorphic to MGN. And these are symplectic forms, so they are called Sage and Van-Richardson. Symplectic forms. And what we can do is to
compute. Is it true that for the hyperbolic model, for any value of the boundary length, is diffeomorphic, canonically diffeomorphic to MGM?
I think so.
I think via the spine construction, it's going to be homomorphic to the fibers of the combinatorial. Which so then, I think it's clearer on that side.
The MGN is the one with punctures or with boundaries?
So this is the moduli space of curves, and here...
Because the one with punctures is an orbifold.
Yes.
Whereas the one upstairs is a manifold for positive boundary length. For Teichner space, I'm maybe
yes.
Agree.
But in, yeah. Okay, I'm not sure about this. I thought it was the same, but yeah. Let me just erase this. But yeah. And anyway, in both cases, what we can do is to compute these volumes. So we can say each or 500 volumes. And the main point is that they can be computed recursively on the other characteristic. And in particular, this recursion is equivalent to topological recursion. So this will be my starting point for today. So my plan now, so for today's talk, the plan is to first recall the definition of PR. And give some examples. So the examples I want to talk about are these constellations and Newton's model. And then I want to give the example for fluid numbers. And then something about Matrix volumes. And then what I wanted to do is to state the main theorem of these two talks, which is the relation between PR and theory. And then discuss this theorem in the above examples. Okay, so this is the plan. Okay, so let me start with recalling the definition of topological recursion. So we have to start with the definition of spectral curve. So a spectral curve is the data S. Where so sigma is a Riemann surface, and not necessarily compact nor connected, it's not a problem. Then we want x and y. So these are functions from sigma to c that are holomorphic. And we want b to be asymmetric, meromorphic b differential. Sigma with the following properties, so with poles on the diagonal plane, and such that this locally is this formula holds, so B. Close to the diagonal, so where is that one, then two, that two, has to behave in this way. So we have this behavior plus holomorphic part. So from now on, I will just denote this this standard symmetric differential in this way with this circle here. Okay. And moreover, we want the following things. So we want the EX. It has to have a finite number of zeros. I will denote them by A belonging to this finite set alpha. And all of them, they have to be simple. So this is important. And then we want dy to be different from zero on alpha. Okay, so these are the conditions. Okay, so this condition will basically implies that y of z close to each of these branch points is behaving in this way, so it's behaving in this way. way, with this guy different from zero. And here, since the poles are simple, we can take these coordinates here, plus something that goes by x. Okay. And I will denote this function here, which is a function locally defined near A. I will denote it by zeta A of z. Okay. And just another notation. So from these conditions, we also have that there exists a unique evolution that I will denote by sigma of A. This is defined close to the branch points. So this is a neighborhood of A. So it's an evolution, and it's such that it fixes X. And sigma is different from A. Okay, so the pictures you have to have in mind is something like this. So imagine to have C squared here, and then the spectral curve is curved like this, so this is sigma. And X and Y are the projections in this case, and the branch points are something like this. So for example, here is A. And the evolution sigma is the one defined near A and exchanging these two fields. Okay. So this is the definition of spectral curve. And from this we can define the topological recursion amplitudes. So even a spectral curve set omega 0, 1 to be y dx. We set omega 0, 2 to be this function in this branch of E. And then we set for minus 2 plus and greater than 0, we define the following amplitudes. So we set omega dn to be the sum over all branch points, and then we take the residue, or is that going to A, of a certain kernel that I'm times, and here we have all our amplitudes for higher other characteristics. So we have omega g minus 1 and plus 1 evaluated as z, and then this evolution. This plus sum over all possible splittings, so it's g1 plus g2 equals g, then I1 and I2 is the partition of this set, and we avoid 0, 1, so no disks, and then we take omega g1 here all the variables associated to this set times omega g2 first example is the easiest spectral curve you can think about. So this is related to the recursion. And the curve is called the area curve. So this spectral curve is given by the following data. So as a ring on surface, you take C. X is that square. Take Y E minus Z. And as B, you take the what I denoted by the circle.
Yep. It's
still there, probably. Yes. So it's this standard one. Okay. And the statement is that if you compute the amplitudes from that formula there, and so here we have global coordinates, so we can get rid of these differentials. So this is a coefficient to the other characteristic times the following Laplace transform. So this. And then you take the Laplace transform of these on-stage volumes. So this clarifies what I said at the beginning, that these on-stage volumes are computed recursively by topological recursion. So this is the precise statement. And the second example is basically, it is quite similar, so related to mechanical recursion. So here we take S to be against C and take X to be Z squared again. And now what we have to change is Y, so take Y to be 1 over 2 pi sine of 2 pi z, and take b to be the standard of 1. Okay. So if we take this initial data, then the outcome is like above, but with these with the Concevich volumes substituted by the Peterson volumes. If you start from this initial data and you take this Laplace transform, here you take simple coordinate numbers, this partition mu, and then here, these are simple coordinate numbers, so they are counting connected branch covers of P1 with surfaces of genus G and with simple branch points, except for the one where infinity, whose ramification profile is given by mu. Okay, so this is another example, and the third one that I want to present is related to the Maxwell's problems. So in this case, take as a spectral curve the following one. So it's C. Then x is z squared. Y is minus z. And take B to be the following. Let me first write it, and then I will explain the notation. So here, psi is the nth order polynomial function. So it is defined as the nth derivative of the log of the normal function. Okay. And the relation to Maxwell's volumes is the following.
Isn't there a simpler expression for this B?
Sorry?
Isn't there a simpler expression for this B?
Yes.
Using the reflection formula.
I use this expression because it's useful for the computations.
Okay.
But yeah, the easiest expressions in terms of 1 over sine. I don't remember exactly how it is, but I prefer these just for the computations.
Sorry, I have a question. On part 3, so we can't expand around z equals 0.
Yes. You said you...
What is the meaning of the formula you wrote there? I mean, in the previous two formulas, the curve was the complex numbers, and I can think of expanding informal power series of zi, where each zi is a variable formal power around 0. Here, I don't know the meaning of the formula because I can't expand.
We're expanding your exponent of x equal to 0.
So these are around
where are we expanding?
Sorry?
Where are we expanding around?
So it should be around the critical points of this, that should be x equal to 1, right? So it's, as Daniel was saying, around exponential of x of z equal to 0.
Yeah, so z goes to 0 amounts to exponential of x going to 0, to the right branch. And that's just the lower under the series expansion.
But z goes to 0.
Z goes to 1.
Oh, to 1. I see.
Why is you say z goes to 1?
You can't expand around z goes to 0 because there is a sensor.
You take exponential of x.
Yes, yeah, so z goes to 1. It's the critical point.
So it's z times exponential of minus z. that does make sense from 0 to 0.
But in the left hand side, you can't expand into form forces in Zi.
You can, because omega gn is for 2g minus 2 plus n positive. They're a meromorphic, I mean, they're Russian, sorry. They don't have poles at the poles of x, at the singularity of x. And y, they only have poles at the zeros of x prime. So they're globally defined.
Okay, so the multivalueness is not playing any role?
No.
The one over the log. Okay, so the relation in this case with the Mazurovich volume is the following. So I take a different normalization of these Mazurovich volumes. So these are the Mazurovich volumes of the space of quadratic differentials after this normalization. And the relation is the following. So if you take this residue, this one is the easiest one, and is the easiest spectral curve you can think about. This is a bit more difficult because you are changing y to something something strange. And for the Lambert curve, you are changing x to something difficult. And in this case, what you are changing is this b. And as you will see, this will make things difficult, more difficult in different ways. These are the four examples I want to discuss. And in particular, what I want to state now is the theorem relating topological recursion to the intersection theory. So, just to fix the notation. Right now, I will take a general spectral curve, but with just one branch point that I will denote by A, and then I will set x naught to be x evaluated of this branch point A. I already told you that close to A, I can always define this function to be x of z minus x0. Okay. So then the main theorem of today is the following. This is a theorem by A9. So for x, as before, there exist some differentials. That are given by big psi k of z for k from 0 to 7. And there exists a class that I will denote by lambda, g and s, and this is a topological class on m, g and bar, such that the following relation holds. So if you compute this omega g n from this spectral curve, these are a factor, so to the dgn. So dgn is
discuss these examples. And again, these relation holds for a stable gene.
So is this the psi defined combinatorially or geometrically?
So this is the first thing that I'm going to define. So okay. I will write this for you now. So okay. So these big psi are defined in terms of if you want, they are defined in terms of the geometry of the spectral curve. So they are defined in this way. So they are minus the residue for z going to the range point A of this B. And then you have only number of buffer to K minus 1 double buffer, divided by 2 K, and then this function zeta z to 2 K plus 1. So this is a differential, and you're taking the residue, and the result is a differential for monosurface. So these are the first things. And to define the class, I need to define two functions. So first I define these two. So we define g of u, which will have an expansion of this form. So this, I will denote these coefficients by t hat. And these are defined with the Laplace transform of omega 0 1. sum over all divisors. I will first write it and then I will explain it better. Take the push forward, and here it says the S on side classes, and then you take exponential of G evaluated on power classes. So, let me explain this. So this is a sum over the divisors of any n bar. So it's, if you want, in terms of stable graphs, is the sum over all these guys here, and then all possible stable graphs of this one, two, three. And in this case, this iota is just the attaching map. And you take the push forward of this class. So this class here is just the sum over k and l of this coefficient. So that is the expansion of B, but then you evaluate on psi to the k, psi prime to the L, and these psi and psi prime are the psi classes on the nodes, on the two half edges, let's say. And here this G evaluated on kappa classes is just the shorthand notation to, and here is the kappa indexed by n. Okay. So these are the definitions. And so how to use this theory? So when you have a spectral curve with these properties here, what you have to do is to compute these differentials, this function, the coefficient of the expansion of this g and this b hat, and then you put all together in this formula here to complete this course. So what I want to do now is just to start from these examples and try to compute those classes and see how to use this formula. In the first examples, the computations are actually not so hard. It's more scary to state the theorem than to actually do the computations. So let me start with the first example, which is the area curve.
Yeah, before doing that, can you say what is this there? Psi prime?
So psi and psi prime are the psi classes on the half edges. So here, yeah, this is a bit of notation in the sense that these classes, they live in different spaces every time you take this push forward. But for example here, these psi and psi classes are living in the homology of this. And they are the psi classes on the two nodes that then you want to keep. And the same here. So this is always, I use the same notation, but they mean different classes for each element in that sum. Okay. So I want to show you the computations for this curve. So let me remind you that this is something like this. You see, then x is given by z squared, y is given by minus z, and b is the standard one. Okay. So now you can see that the critical points, there is just one critical point, a here you should put zeta, which is just z, to the 2k plus 1. Okay, so this residue is not so difficult. And the result is minus 2k plus 1 factorial divided by 2 to the k, and then z0 is 2k plus 2. Okay, so this is the list of differentials.
Supposed to expand the z0 minus z square around 0.
Yes, this is very good.
But unless z0 is 0, then it's regular. So you're not going to pick up a residue.
On the right?
Oh, there is another one to the. No. Oh, there is that one. I see.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah, okay. Thank you.
So it's.
I didn't read that. I thought it was another 2.
No.
Yeah,
the coefficient of z to the 2k in the expansion of this.
Yeah.
Okay, so this integral, it's quite easy. So minus 2. Okay. And if you recall, the times that are defined in terms of the expansion of g, so what you obtain from this is that p hat 0 is equal to minus log of minus 2, and all the other times are equal to 0 or n, which is equal to 1. Okay? And then the last thing we have to conclude is this b hat. So I will leave
sorry, is little gamma real or positive reals?
Sorry?
Is little gamma, the contour, reals or the positive reals?
It doesn't really matter because then we are in
no, the I know, but you wrote little gamma there, it's in R plus.
Oh, no, that one, sorry. Yeah, it's the whole area line because is the set of z such that x of z minus x naught is positive reals. In that case, you have z squared minus 0 in the positive real.
Oh, z squared, right.
Okay,
thank you.
Yeah, so this is cool.
Okay.
So it's x that has to be
positive
real, so all z, the z in the real.
Thank
you. So the last thing to do is to compute p. But in this case, it's quite trivial because if you see from this definition here, so you have to compute b associated to the spectral curve minus this b circle evaluated at zeta. But in this case, we have that b is equal to b hat, and zeta is the identity, and this implies that b hat is equal to zero. So we have no contribution from this. And so what we have to do now is to collect everything in this class, and taking into account that this b is equal to zero and the times are dead, you think that the class associated to this hairy curve is equal to minus 2 to the other characteristic. This is because kappa zero the differential is dealing with this. Okay, and if you put this together with what I said at the beginning, as a consequence, you find that these are nothing but the Laplace transform of these conceptuals. So this is something that actually Concevich proved in his 1993 paper. So this actually relates these volumes, so the volumes of the moduli space of Ribbon graphs, with psi-classic intersection numbers. So this statement, if you want, is also somehow the Witten conjecture. Okay, so this is the first example. And the other example that I wanted to design, the second one is this Neoplatonic curve. Changes in this case is just this definition of this G. So to compute it, we have to just erase that. But the computation is the following. So we have to integrate on R. Again, we have e to the minus u x, which is z squared. And then we have to take dy. So we have minus here, and then cosine of 2 pi z. Okay, and if you solve this integral, what you find is minus 2 exponential of minus pi squared divided by u. Okay, and from the definition of times, what you find is that this t hat 0 is again minus log of minus 2. And now you have also time 1, which is equal to pi squared. And all the others are equal to 0.
So when you do this integral, do you assume that, say, u is positive or something?
Yes, exactly. Yes.
I see.
Yeah, thanks. Is real.
was equal to minus z plus log of n. Y is equal to z, and e is the standard log. So the main problem here is that this zeta is not the identity anymore, but it's something like this. So it's minus zeta plus log plus 1. So you can see that even, for example, if you want to compute the xi, this will involve 1 over this zeta to some power, and the computations for these are quite difficult. And actually, what the trick is not to compute this, but to compute, to express this in terms of the following expressions. So let's say express in terms of expressions. So what one can actually compute is xi is 0. And then express all the others in terms of this. This is the trick to avoid computing them explicitly. And then what one can do is to actually compute this GU. This is quite okay. And then compute this V hat. And this can be computed in terms of V. I don't have time to explain these computations. They are quite involved. So if you're really interested in that, I will upload the computations on the website. But basically, this is the main idea, and there are many computational tricks. And what I wanted to say is just the final result, because I think it's really interesting. So if you compute this class and you express everything, what you obtain is a formula involving the Topological bundle. And actually, to compute this class, you also need to use Hodge formula, Manifold formula that I presented last time. The final result is something like this. So omega gm computed from the Lambert curve. They compute like there's a certain homeopathic factor, and then you have a sum over em. And here what you can find is actually the first term class of the Hodge bundle, the dual of the Hodge bundle, and then you intersect it with all possible psi classes. And instead of adding those differentials, you actually have the differentials. So let me do this function here by psi A. So there's an expression of these in terms of that, and vice versa. And it turns out that those differentials are better for this kind of computations. So sorry, this is di. There's a di. And comparing this to with what I said at the beginning, that these differentials, they compute somehow the Hurwitz numbers. What we well, before you wrote the two integrals, one was a Gaussian, the other was also a shifted Gaussian.
Yes. So,
so what's an integral?
The easiest one
involved in this.
The easiest one is g, the one completing g.
Okay.
So in this case, for example, e, you know, e is okay, yeah, this factor. And here, so I don't remember exactly the trick, but it was something like this. And here you should have the plus one. That is x of z. And here we have z. So this is the type of integral, and this gamma in the plane, it will be something like this.
Mm-hmm.
And what you can do is to compute this, you can deform the contour around the axis, and you will find the gamma function will pop out from this, and using Stirling approximation formula, you will find this coefficient of g of u in terms of Bernoulli numbers. And the Bernoulli numbers are the ones coming in this Hodge factor as well.
So you can compute them with residue theorem, essentially?
With actually complex analysis, with the residue theorem.
In fact, there's a simple way to see the gamma function. Because this integral is supposed to be exponential of minus x times y dx. So up to integration by part is just dy. And y is a global coordinate because the curve is exponential of x equal y equal exponential of minus y. So you keep dy as the coordinate, and then you have exponential of minus x, which is just to the power u, which is just y exponential of minus y to the power u. And you see directly that's a gamma function. You just have to check the contour is the correct one.
Oh, not even residue.
No,
just
no,
change of variable.
Yeah. Just complex analysis tools. You can deform the integrals because everything is homomorphic, and that's it. And this is the easiest part. What I found really, really difficult is to compute these residues because actually you don't compute them explicitly. So yeah.
You mean there is no closed formula?
No. I mean, not that I know. They're expressed in terms of this. And these are polynomials, algebraic functions that are computed recursively. Yeah, I don't think there's a closed formula for those. I don't know if someone of you knows. Okay, and just to conclude, I want to present the last example. So in this case, as I told you, the main problem is that this zeta is not the identity, and this is creating a lot of computational problems. But this is not the case for these non-zero forms. So the computations are a bit easier. X0 and X0. involves just x and y. So it's exactly as in your case. So we have that t at 0 is minus log of 2, or minus 2, and all the other times are equal to 0. And what is a bit different are the differentials and the d hat. So the differentials are not so difficult again. So what you have to compute is this ratio. You have to take this d. What you have to take is to take the coefficient of z to the 2k in the expansion of that function, which is not so difficult, and what you define is this expression. So you have to take higher order polynomial functions. All of them have odd order. This is minus set. And there is this normalization. It's 2 to the 2k plus 1 k plus 1. So we need these. So it's not so difficult, and also b hat is not very difficult. So the integral in this case is something like this. And if you integrate over r squared, e to the minus u1 z1 squared minus u2 z2 squared, and then you have to take that function and subtract to it the standard differential. So what you can do is to expand this, and the expansion is quite easy, and everything boils down to compute this type of integrals, these double Gaussian integrals of functions that we expand. So as long as you are able to compute this, you are able to compute this b hat, and that will give us the answer.
So are you expanding the logarithmic derivatives of the gamma S power series?
Exactly.
And then it's good term by term.
And yes, and the coefficients are I will write the answer. So the coefficients are polygamma functions evaluated at 1.
Mm-hmm.
And this can be expressed in terms of zeta values.
Okay.
Zeta values, the fact that you have just the zeta values are just even zeta values, so everything can be expressed again in terms of Bernoulli numbers and powers of pi. So if you collect all together, again, I will upload this computation, so if you're really interested in that, you can find them. So if you collect everything, what you obtain in the end is the following class. So the 2k plus 2 divided by 2k plus 2 k plus 4 L. And then psi plus psi prime 2k. Okay, so this is the class associated to the Masurovich volumes, and together with the residue formula to compute Masurovich volumes, what you can find is that these Masurovich volumes are with this normalization that I took are the following ones. So it's basically the integral on G and bar of this class here. So I guess this is a new expression for these Masurovich volumes, and
Do you have psi classes for?
Sorry, come again.
Do you have the usual psi classes for?
No, because the omega gn are computing in terms of that, but then you have to compute the residues. And the only terms contributing to the residues are the ones with no psi classes. And with this, I'm done. I just wanted to say a couple of things. So the theorem that I stated here is for spectral curves with just one branch point. But this can be easily generalized to spectral curves with more branch points. This is not a problem, it's just those two have to write it down. And the other thing I wanted to say is, well, the idea of the proof of this, and the idea is to first prove it for the area curve. So it was actually a lie when I said that this proves also Newton conjecture, because you have to assume that to prove this. And after you prove it for this base case, then you can use the deformation theory for spectral curves to prove it for a general spectral curves. And the last remark is that there is a kind of converse theorem of this. This is due to Barkowski, Quanton, Chadrin, and Spitz, which says that simplifying the statement is you can say that every time you have a semi-simple cohomological field theory, you can think of it as this class lambda, you can construct a spectral curve which is basically doing this this business here. So there's actually a kind of equivalence between topological recursion and semi-simple cohomological field theories. Just simplifying the statement, but this is the main message. And with this, I said that.
Any questions?
So if you wanted this lambda S of Gn to come from S, does it impose conditions on lambda Gns?
Yes.
They cannot be chosen independently.
No, indeed. So you can see from the definition that, for example, it's always topological, because it's always defined in terms of psi, kappa classes, and push forward with attaching maps. So it's always topological. But as I said, somehow it's basically the same as having a semi-simple cohomological field theory. So it's a tautological semi-simple. There are quite some restrictions.
In this correspondence, is cohomological theory, can you read, for example, the genus of the spectral curve?
something like this?
The genus of the spectrum.
Or the number of branch points or this kind of thing? They transfer in this correspondence or not nicely?
I don't know exactly.
Because it's one type per curve, right? For one.
So
the number of branch points you can read that the size of the arithmetics.
Okay, yeah, right.
Right.
So in this case, it's always one-dimensional in this statement
mm-hmm.
here. But if you have more branch points, then you have higher dimensional multiple theories. The genus of the curve, I don't know.
So the genus is not well defined, because what you really need is a local spectral curve.
Yeah, right.
It's just the germ of the curve near the branch points.
Mm-hmm.
And then you have many ways of trying to embed it in a global compact thing.
Mm-hmm.
So what they claim recently that on some conditions on the curve FT, I mean still doing Bakowski Valentin shadow, is that you can always do it in genus zero. If you like. And that's useful for other aspects. But for topological recursion you just need the local thing, so the genus doesn't matter.
Mm-hmm.
You just have this collection of N disks.
Mm-hmm. And this is also why this theorem, I mean, why would you expect a theorem like this? It's just because the definition of these omega gn are in terms of residues. So as long as you know all coefficients of the expansion of b and y, then you are able to actually express these in terms of these coefficients. And somehow this theorem is saying that how to pack all these coefficients together. And express also the relation between them and the summer.